Good evening, all. So my name is Parag. So I'll be talking on the Flatpaks topic, Flatpaks, a sandboxing technology. So the topics that I'm going to cover in this session are introduction to Flatpaks, a concept, features. There is one more concept called a Flathub. Then some of the commands we will see. And if time permits, we will see the demo of a very simple application of how you can run a Flatpak. So, introduction. So what is Flatpak actually? So Flatpak is another way of packaging. So it's an option to distribute a desktop applications. Okay, it's a packaging format. Applications are run in a sandbox when you run a Flatpak. What happens? I think you all know what sandbox means. It's in an isolated environment where processes are run. So your desktop application can be run isolated from the host system. That is nothing but a sandboxing. And when you run any application, what happens that sometimes that application need to be need some dependencies to be installed prior. So this Flatpak comes with either dependencies always, or you can pull the dependencies. So dependencies are distributed either as a runtime or a bundle. Flatpak applications are made to be run on any Linux distribution because their base is a runtime and which is common to any Linux distribution. Currently, Alexander Larson is a lead developer who is working on developing further the Flatpak concept. Flatpaks is an easy way to work on upstream projects by its developers and users. What happens that developers always demand that they need to ensure that their development always works on the Linux distributions. Now, what happens that then they need to always make sure that that Linux distribution they always be having is working fine and it is not breaking anything and they can properly run their new development. Now, this requires a lot of things, but Flatpak is an easy way for the developers that comes to their rescue that can help them to run the latest developed code on their favorite Linux distribution. So Flatpak can help the developers as well as the users who want to test this recent development done by the upstream, different upstream projects. So it's an easy way to work on the upstream project by its developers and users. Flatpak package is available in the repositories of most of the distributions now because it is under development since last 2-3 years heavily. There are a few more packaging formats that are similar to the Flatpak. One is an app image and one is a snaps. So snaps basically, if you are an Ubuntu user, you will be knowing snaps about the thing. So these two are packaging formats that are similar to Flatpaks, but we are going to check how Flatpaks is useful to the Linux developers as well as the users. And again, this Flatpak is not tied to anything particular like GNOME, Fedora, or Systemd. Now Flatpak is coming for KDE also, Qtify also, for Toolkit, for Electron applications. So different framework toolkit, a Flatpak is available, and you can use the Flatpak and develop the applications. We will see what Flatpak concept is actually. So Flatpak uses the OST. What is OST? OST is basically a Git for the binary objects, so binary files. So OST is nothing but OST provides an immutable OS where a basic operating system is being installed, and you can install a parallel, similar, another OST for testing. So you can run a parallel operating systems using the concept of the OST. So Flatpak uses the OST to distribute and manage the applications as well as the needed runtimes. Flatpak repositories follows the OST format, and then the Flatpak packaging uses the atomic way to update the system. So what is this atomic way? Atomic way guarantees that either the update will happen on your system or it is not going to happen at all. So it's not like that. If you took a traditional Linux operating system like, say, Fedora, and you are just pulling some bunch of the updates, and you found that some update is broken or some update is needed, some updated dependency, and it's not available. So that is not the case if you are using an OS tree. So that is one of the benefit of the OS tree, that is immutable OS. So if you want to try OS tree in Fedora, we are working on the Fedora Silverview, a new distribution. So you can check it, and you can see how OS tree can be used. When a Flatpak is run, an isolated environment is created. When the runtime is mounted on the slash user, and the applications are mounted on slash app. So in the OS tree formatted system, you get only two mount points, that is slash user and slash app. Every other mount points are read-only on the OST system. So on slash user, the runtimes are getting mounted, and on slash app, the actual application get mounted. We will see that when we come to see the exact example of the Flatpak. So this is how a typical diagram is there. About the Flatpak. So basically, your host operating system is at the lower. On top of the host operating system, you need to first ensure that the needed SDKs, say suppose you are working on some GNOME application, so you need to first install the GNOME platform runtime, then the GNOME free desktop. There are both the SDKs are available. A GNOME SDK is available, free desktop SDK is available. It depends what your application is needed. So you need to ensure that first these runtimes are installed on your system. So that's what the runtime is there. And on top of this runtime, then using this runtime, you can run the different applications. And each application is run in its own isolated platform, its own isolated environment. So these are that diagram that illustrates that. Suppose there are three different applications that can be run in a three different Flatpaks, and all can be run on a same host system, and they can use the same runtimes. Even they can use a different runtimes. Say suppose if one application needed a GNOME 3.32 platform, or another application need a 3.28 platform, so that is possible, because I just told you that in OST formatted system, we can install the OST parallelly. So different runtimes can be installed on the same system parallel, like 3.28 version, 3.30 version, 3.32 version. You choose whichever you want, build your application and run it. So you have the flexibility of using the required dependency for your application. So I just explained that. It is a program, application is any program of your interest and any additional libraries it needed, which is bundled up in the Flatpak package. Applications are not permitted to use the host system resources unless explicitly requested by them. So applications can request a different permissions, and based on these permissions, the host system resources can be used by the Flatpak application. Like if they want to utilize an audio, if they want to utilize a system which is mounted on a different partition, so these all can be possible. You just need to add the respective snippet into the manifest file. So manifest file is the file which is need to be written so that you can build the application. We will see the example. Runtime, I just explained you, so I will skip it. So Flatpak system. So what is Flatpak systems? It's a you can install application, either a system-wide application, or even you can install a Flatpaks a per user basis. So if you are going to install a Flatpak on a system-wide, the path where this application will be installed is a var lib Flatpak app. And if you want to install the same Flatpak as a user, then it will be installed into your home directories .local share Flatpak and app directory. Now, each application or runtime, whatever, will then have a further directory structure, like after var lib Flatpak app, there will be a name. So this name can be a dotted format name, like suppose if you want to or I better show you var lib Flatpak app. So I have this is almost 6 Flatpak applications are installed on my system. So we will take an example of a gedit. So see, on this standard platform system-wide varlib Flatpak app, I have this org gnome.gedit. Let me add the font to be Ah, that does not look good. So this is the application directory that gets created on your system when you install a Flatpak app. And in this application directory, there is always a current is a directory which is linked to the architecture which you want to run. There can be different architecture like i686 or x86 64. Currently, I have a 64 bit application installed. So let's move to the 64 bit directory. And then I'm using a stable branch. You have a choice to use which branch. So under the architecture, there are different choices like a stable branch or suppose if it's a GNOME, so 3.32 branch, 3.30 branch, or 3.28 branch. And then actual hash of your application's OS tree comes. And below that, you can check the files that got installed as part of your gedit application. So under the bin, you can find the gedit binary. So this is how an Flatpaks directory structure will look like on your system when you install Flatpak. So yeah, this is what I mean by the third bullet point. Name architecture branch is the structure. A standard structure will also show you these files like per application you can find a deploy, export, files, metadata. These are also a standard directory structure of a Flatpak application. So sandboxing. So how this, what is sandboxing actually? Flatpak's main concept is based on the sandboxing, and that is nothing but based on the bubble wrap tool. So Flatpak uses Project Atomic's bubble wrap tool, to provide a containerized environment. So existing container runtime tools are not suitable to give up to unprivileged users. So what happens that you always need a privileged users to run the containers. With the Flatpak, you got an option to run the Flatpak using the unprivileged users. Now, bubble wrap command, bw wrap command is always run as a PID one when you run a sandbox application, that is a Flatpak. So we will see whether it's really a PID one or not. So that helps to handle, again, BW wrap also helps to handle the ripping children in the sandbox. So what is ripping children, suppose? What happens that sometimes parent creates some multiple processes, and sometimes parent itself get died, and the children becomes orphan. So now in order to, what to do with these children? So these children are taken care by this PID one. That is nothing but it's a ripping the children in the sandbox. Sandboxing again. So several Linux kernel features are being used when the sandboxing happens. That is nothing but a C groups and the namespaces. These are the kernel features that are getting used for this sandbox environment. So Flatpak applications are protected from each other because of their own isolated environment. Flatpak applications have extremely limited access to the host environment. So so the permissions are the thing. So I can show you. So we have this doc flatpak.org website where you will find all the good documentation related to the Flatpak. So here the permissions is also having its own page, and here you can find that different permissions can be granted to the Flatpak application. So these are the standard permissions like share whether you want to allow sharing the network or showing the windows using the X11, or if you want to use a VLAN, then socket is pulse audio or not. So these all are different permissions that you can grant to your application while building the Flatpak application. Even a file system access, if you want to give access to the normal files, then file system is equal to host, you can write. if you want to just give to the home user's home directory, then you can just add a file system is equal to home. So this is how the permissions can be given. So these permissions are actually written in a manifest file. Also, sandboxing makes it easy to uninstall the application. OK, features of the Flatpak. So Flatpaks are nothing but you can build it once and run on any Linux distribution. Only what you need is that the base libraries or runtimes that need to be prior installed, or if it is not prior installed, they may get bundled with that same application. So it depends on the application, whether to pull the basic runtime or it is already having that bundled with the same application. Now, by having it fragmented into different applications or runtimes, it will help you to reduce the size of the application. There are easy build tools are available like Flatpak Builder. It provides cleaner auto-updating experience. Intended for basically the Flatpaks are intended for the desktop GUI application, but you can even use it for the shell script. But basically, its main purpose for writing this Flatpak thing is for the desktop GUI application. Currently, these different operating systems are using the Flatpak concept. Fedora is having a Flatpaks. You can install it anytime. Ubuntu is also having Gentoo, Magisia, Deepin. And if you are knowing, Endless OS is the first OS that is purely using the Flatpaks. There is no arbitrary code execution happening at the install time as a root user, so you should be safe. No arbitrary files are getting dropped at the arbitrary location when you install the Flatpak. It allows application maintainers to choose their dependencies separately. Like I just explained, you choose your own platform, be it a GNOME 3.28, 30, or 3.32. Choose your own platform and build your application and run it. It provides a way of testing different versions of the application also. Now there is one more thing called as a Flathub. So Flathub is like a kind of a distribution website where a lot of applications which are getting built daily, they are hosted there. It's basically a central hosting repository. So you just need to enable that hosting repository on your system and start pulling the applications. So yeah, I mean, the second bullet shows you that Flatpak remote add -- if not exists Flathub. And this is the repo that you can add. These are the different Flatpak commands are there. So I think I will skip them. And I can show you. So what I was telling you, so this is the manifest file that you need. So this is very simple. It starts with the application ID. You need to write application ID. Say, suppose org.flatpak.hello. Then on which runtime it is based? Suppose it's based on the org freedesktop.platform. What's the runtime version? It's 18.08. Then which SDK it depends on? You need to write an org freedesktop SDK. Then what's the command? So I'm just running this Flatpak just to run a shell script, a single shell script. Now, this is the format, the way you need to write it. So I don't think I have time to explain everything. But in simple terms, what are the sources that are getting used to build the application? It's just a simple file, type is file, and script is hello.sh. And when you build it, and when you try to install this Flatpak, just install it into the app bin hello.sh path. OK. So. And my hello.sh is very simple, echo hello world from sandbox and ps-aux. So this command I have exclusively added to make sure that I will show you that when you get inside the sandboxing, the first PID is always a bwrap. So I have this couple of commands ready to show you. So I will just run it. So the first to ensure that the Flatpak main repository has been enabled, from where we can pull the runtimes and needed other applications. Okay, so now the second command is Flatpak remote. So that will tell you that what different remotes. Remotes are nothing but the remote repositories from where I can pull the runtime libraries or the application. So I have on my system currently a Fedora, Flatpak, GNOME app nightly, and test repo. The test repo is the one that I'm going to demo now, is there. So these are the five repos are available, or in Flatpak terms, it's called as the remotes are available. Now, let's check whether a test repo, what this test repo, what provides it. So Flatpak remote LS test repo, and what kind of applications are available in this test repo. So only one application is available. So it output you that org Flatpak hello, application ID is org Flatpak hello, and it's a branch is master. OK. Now, what I'm trying to do at here is that I'm trying to delete the the command for the test repo deleting is Flatpak remote delete test repo. So I just delete it. So it just remove the hello world application. OK. After that, the command I ran is that Flatpak builder. So this is the Flatpak builder into the build dir. In this directory, all the whatever the building happens, all the files are getting placed in this directory. I'm using a force clean to make sure that if this directory already exists, it gets clean first, it recreated, and I have given a repo name as a my repo, and the manifest file from which we are building the Flatpak app is nothing but the last argument, that is org flatpak hello.json. OK. Now, after that, this is the command to check to add this test repo on my system again, because I have removed that test repo remote. Now I'm adding again that test repo remote, and I'm again checking whether what apps are available. So it again gives the same output that org flatpak hello is available. OK. Now I'm going to install it in a user mode. So Flatpak user mode install from the test repo org flatpak.hello application. OK. So it's just checking whether that application is really available. Yes, it's available. And it is asking me whether I should proceed or not. I just proceeded. And now I just ran it using this command, flatpak run org flatpak hello. So this is the output of the shell script. And then the second line was ps-aux. So the command's output, you can see. The first PID is always a BW wrap command. So this is what proves that we have actually got the output from the sandbox environment, so isolated environment. So this is how I just ran a simple Flatpak application. All this information is also available on this doc.flatpak.org, a first build, building the first Flatpak application. All these steps are written here, so you can go through it. The same example is given here. Now I have only two slides. So future. So now the future that Fedora project is looking is building a next distribution or a next release using only the Flatpaks, but that will take some time. And yeah, summary. So Flatpak is improving every release of every different Linux distribution or a Fedora distribution. It's helpful to users to test under the development app environment, for the development application also. It auto-installs the dependencies, because we have already seen that manifest file is the file where we need to write all the dependencies while building the application. So it always ensures that the dependencies will get pulled when you install your Flatpak application. Now the Flatpak is integrated with the GNOME Center also, so you can pull the application, search the application in GNOME Center also. So currently Flatpak, on the Flathub repository, there are around more than 500 Flathub applications are available today. So I think that's what my presentation is all about. So anybody got any questions for this topic, Flatpak? Yes.
I just wanted to know what BZAP was. Is that the binary which is responsible for implementing the sandbox?
Sorry, BWRAP?
Yeah.
So it's actually a tool written sometime back, and it's getting got converted to enable more kernel features so that it can provide you a containerized environment, sandbox environment.
Okay. Okay, thank you.
Yes?
You're mentioning that moving forward, most of the Linux distros is going to push for all these Flatpak distributions, right? Does that mean for every Flatpak application, the dependencies is going to be packaged together and that's going to bloat up your home directory, or it's going to increase the storage that it requires?
Increase your storage.
Because if it's two Flatpak applications that require the same dependencies, but it's going to be repeated, right?
No. That is the feature of the OST, deduplication. So OST helps you with that. So if, suppose, two different applications require the same runtime or same dependency, are you asking that?
Yes.
Both will pull same runtime again or install it twice?
Yes.
No, that is not going to happen.
Oh, so if it's the same dependencies, it's only a single copy?
Yes.
Okay, thanks.
Only single copy. So that is what I explained you, like that different structure, like architecture and below architecture, there are different versions are there, 3.28, 3.30 also. So that way also, multiple different versions can be installed on the same system as well. Any more questions? If not, then okay.
Okay, well, thank you.
Yeah. Thank you all. Thank you.